Your church may look like a church, but may not be one. Here are a number of checks to see if your church is indeed a church or just a spiritual club. Let's get straight down to it. Is the Bible taught in your church? Does your church teach the scriptures? Do you have gifted Bible teachers conducting regular Bible studies, insisting that you be rooted and grounded in the Word of God? Is the Word of God honored in its entirety? Do your church leaders say that the Bible is 100% inspired, or do they claim that parts of the Bible are not inspired? Is the Bible taught uncompromisingly? Are you taught to obey the Word of God? A false church leader would want you to stay ignorant, as he can then control you easily. A perfect church member for these unscrupulous leaders is one who comes to church regularly, gives money regularly, does not ask any questions, blindly accepts everything that he is taught. But a genuine spiritual leader will insist that you read, study, and understand the Word of God for yourself. And so he will have weekly Bible studies to ensure that the Bible is taught to every member of the church. The members of the Berean church did just that and verified for themselves that even Paul was indeed speaking the truth. And so should you verify what your priests or pastors are teaching you. If your church does not teach the Bible, it can only lead to one of these two conclusions. 1. Your church leaders do not know the Bible themselves. Or 2. They do not want you to know the Bible. Does your church meet regularly for prayer? Or are its members too busy to pray for one another? The modern world has too many distractions for a church's members to meet once a week for prayer. Some time ago, while attending a church, I insisted on the church having a monthly prayer meeting against the wishes of the pastor, who said that nobody will come for prayer. We were all surprised to see more than 10 members attend the prayer meetings regularly. The prayer itself was very simple. It was designed to make the weakest member comfortable. Just simple prayer, no long-winded prayers, no sophisticated prayer phrases. But that year, the church experienced abundant blessings of God. God honored that simple but joyous time together, and that is what prayer is all about. Does your church help members who are facing problems at work or home or school or even their marriage? Or are these people forced to go elsewhere for support and prayer? This is a corrupt world. Greed and corruption have raised their ugly heads almost everywhere. The Bible teaches us that we are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. So every now and then, you will find a few Christians who stand up to these evil forces. And this being a spiritual war, they may be wounded in the fight. It is the church which should support these warriors in their fight by constantly praying for them and caring for them if they get hurt. But in all probability, these men of God will be on their own and they will not get any support from the church. If your church leaders cannot support you and regularly pray for you, it can only mean that they are not born-again Christians and do not know Jesus. Does your church engage in evangelism? Do you believe in hell and that anyone without Jesus is headed for hell? If you do, or if your church does, what the hell are you doing about it? Many a church sends conscience money for missionary work, but does your church engage in evangelism? When you evangelize and win people for Jesus, you will see newborn babies in the church. I am not talking about physical births. I am talking about spiritual births. This is the joyous pitter-patter of baby feet that even the angels get excited about. And soon you will find spiritual toddlers, spiritual children, spiritual young people, and spiritually mature people, and the process will repeat. If your church is not engaged in evangelism, think about what Jesus meant when he said, "You shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You yourselves do not enter, nor will you let those enter who are trying to." Are there non-believers in your church? If there are non-believers in your church, is there any effort made to bring them to Jesus? This is indeed a ridiculous situation. You are doing nothing to go out and bring people to Jesus. But here, in your own backyard, there are non-believers, but you are doing nothing to bring them to Jesus. In certain churches, they have these yearly conventions where the gospel is preached with power, giving a chance for the unsaved to get saved. The congregation members are exhorted to bring non-Christians for the meetings. But a hidden feature is that the gospel is preached to the non-believers within the church itself. When you stand on Judgment Day before the throne of God, and when you are directed to heaven, while the family that occupied the pew in front of you week after week is sent to hell, how would you answer their accusation that you did not lead them to Jesus all those years while you attended that church? If your church is doing nothing to bring its own members to Jesus, then think about what Jesus meant when he said, "Let the dead bury their dead." Christian nurture, spiritual nourishment. Is your church a nurturing and caring church? Does the leadership care for each member individually? Or do they just give you a collective blessing and send you on your way? If a newborn Christian comes to your church, will he find spiritual nurture? Or will he be left to fend for himself? When a young man left a church and joined a rival church, its members were incensed and wanted to bring him back. My question is, if the young man comes back, will he find Christian nurture within this church? The very reason he left and joined another church? Neither does that church nurture its young people, nor does it allow them to find Christian nurture in another church. Does your church care for ex-cult members? Or rather, is your church equipped to deal with ex-cult members? Does your church even care that there is a couple who are on the verge of a divorce in your own backyard? Is there no one among you who can counsel that young couple and perhaps save that marriage from certain disaster? If your church is not equipped to handle the spiritual needs of these people, think about what Jesus meant when he said, "If the blind lead the blind." Christian nurture, physical provision. James is very clear about the responsibilities of the church. If a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, be warmed and be filled," and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? But how many churches are sensitive to the poor among us? Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress. Does your church care for the executive who lost his job? Or the young man who was thrown out of his home because he wouldn't let go of Jesus? Or a young woman who was saved from the clutches of unscrupulous people who had forced her into prostitution and now she has nowhere to go? Yet our churches are too busy with their activities to even notice that among them there is a family that escaped the clutches of a cult and are struggling to even survive in this world. I know of churches that debate what fixed deposits to put the money into, but have no care for the children of a single mother desperately trying to provide for her family. These people should be cared for, nurtured while they heal from their trauma. But most of all, they should be provided for as they struggle for their very survival, a process which may even take a few years. If your church refuses to care for the unfortunate, it means that its leaders are saying to them rather loudly, "Go in peace, be warmed and be filled." Ungodly as they most certainly are, your church leaders will be hoarding all the church money in fixed deposits. The prosperity gospel preachers. I call this gospel the gospel of greed. Does your church have strong teaching against the prosperity gospel preachers, greedy televangelists, false gospel movements, and dangerous cults? Or is your church leadership as confused, weak, and ignorant as everybody else? Televangelists such as Benny Hinn, Kenneth Copeland, Kenneth Hagin, Mike Murdoch, Peter Popoff, Todd Bentley, Creflo Dollar, Joyce Meyer, Joel Osteen, Paul Crouch, etc. are all false teachers. Does your church take a strong stand against these charlatans? Does your church teach you why these people are wrong and advise you to keep away from them? If your church leaders do not condemn these false teachers, then they are certainly endorsing these wolves in sheep's clothing as legitimate men of God. Because of this stand of theirs, and because they did not take the time and effort to study what these charlatans are actually teaching, should they cause even one child of God to stumble, your church leaders will have to face God's wrath on Judgment Day with a millstone around their necks. Does your church take a stand against social evils, or is your church compromising with some of the evils being touted as good by the world? Example, dowry, caste system, child labor. Does your church take a stand and preach against the evil practices which you see around you? Or does it want to tread carefully and avoid hurting the sentiments of these evildoers? Example, people engaged in homosexuality, feminism, adultery, greed. If your church allows such evil within its walls and beyond and refuses to condemn such practices, then it is compromising with the world. Rites and rituals. Is your church service full of rites and rituals? Do your priest or pastor's monotonous and tuneful prayers resemble a priest's mantras in a temple? Can you understand what your pastor says or prays? Is your church service dull and boring? Are the pastor's message vague and not useful for your Christian life? Does your church uphold men's traditions, abandoning God's word? For example, does your church continue to enforce infant baptism and confirmation, lulling the minds of its members into thinking they are saved when they are not, thus not allowing them to seek God and be saved? Does your church pronounce forgiveness of sins even for everyone, thus encouraging the non-believers to think that their sins are forgiven when they are actually not? If you answered yes, then your church may not be a church at all. A pseudo-spiritual club maybe, but definitely not a church. Church leadership. Are your church leaders born again? If not, it will be a case of the blind leading the blind or the dead burying their dead. Do your church leaders know the Bible? Only then will they be able to teach the scriptures. Do the lives of your church leaders match with the Bible? If not, how can they lead? Are they joyful Christians or are they sad and forlorn? If they are sad and long-faced all day, where is the joy of salvation in them? Are they filled with love or are they sharp and spiteful? The lives of your church leaders should be soaked with the love of Christ. Do they exhibit humility or are they full of toxic pride and arrogance? A buffed up, proud and arrogant leader is not a Christian leader at all. Can you see Christ in them? If one cannot see Christ in a leader, he will not be able to serve the members of his church. If your church leader does not exhibit any biblical characteristics, he is unfit to be a spiritual leader. Perhaps you should find a church which has a godly leader who cares for his people. Only then can you grow in your spiritual life. If you answered yes to any of the above questions, you may not be saved. Please ensure your salvation, as it is a question of eternity and not something that you can take lightly. If you are indeed saved, does your life show it? Can the people around you see Christ in you? Your spiritual leaders may not be saved. In that case, what are you doing in a church whose leadership is blind? If you don't get spiritual nourishment in your church, you need to get it elsewhere. Otherwise, we have a malnourished Christian. A spiritual leader who is controlling and manipulative is not a pleasant alternative. Find another church where you will be lovingly cared for and you can grow to your full potential. Spiritual life is the journey of a seed which bursts into life and grows amidst the chaos and confusion of the world. It is a day-by-day spiritual growth. There is no such thing as stagnation in your spiritual life. Either you are growing or you are a dead seed or a dying plant.